Okay.
Thank you.
closer. So, Lord, we just come before you and say thank you, Lord, for what you've done on the cross for us. We thank you for your grace and mercy that you give, that empowers us to walk the journey out. And so, Lord, yes, we need more grace, more presence, more connection, and to be more in love with you, 2023. So, Lord, we just declare your name, the name of Jesus. We magnify you. We lift you up. There are a lot of things that bring distraction in our lives to us and your name. So, Lord, we just ask that you would first reveal it to us before we get into it as a distraction, and help us run to you. Just hide in the cleft of you. We are safe in your arms, and we are under your care as a shepherd. That even if we are having to walk through a tough earthly season, that you are there, and that you will walk us through it. So, God, we thank you for your grace, empowered, merited favor, grace of Jesus, because of what you've done. Thank you for that, Mark. And Holy Spirit, we ask that you just continue to speak. Lead us and guide us. I ask for your leadership throughout the rest of this service today. Lord, give us eyes to see, ears to hear. That you would be honored and glorified. Our hope rests in you and only you. And so we run to you today. We thank you, Lord, for being that anchor. May be
what your focus is.
announcements?
One of them is we have some ministry needs. See, is that up there yet? You guys can read as well as I can. Looks like we still need some help on Tuesday nights and Wednesday nights. On Tuesday nights, it starts about 6:30, and Wednesday at 7 o'clock for recharge. And we could really use some child care. We could really use some help. Are you going to worth a try, y'all? Also, we've got something going on hiatus. Our MOPS program is going to be, let's see, it says it's been put on hold until further notice. That tells me that the Lord's up to something there. So for those of you who have kiddos or are no mommies who have kiddos, start praying for them right now. This is our chance to pray. And, oh yeah, this is the reason that I wanted to come up here. And I actually volunteered for this, y'all. I ain't got good sense. New Life Academy. That's the one that the Lord's called me to. New Life Recovery is probably not what you think it is. You probably think it's for us drunks and drug addicts. What? I'm a poster child, except I'm not a one. I'm a child of God. Amen. No one can sit here in this church house and say that you don't need what Life Recovery has to offer. It has to offer a way to use the Word of God to live. To live. Folks, I've been clean and sober for 11 years, but I've only been working the program about 3. You can stay sober for a while, but until you work through the issues that caused you to use, caused you to have anger, caused you to be codependent, caused you to overeat. I'm still working on that one. Until you work through those issues that caused you to be where you are, you're going to continually repeat the pattern. And then those patterns don't have to be repeated. They don't have to be. I know there's been talk in the house of people wanting to do an Al-Anon group, and I'm all in. I don't know anything about Al-Anon. Wish I did. But I can tell you that those of us who have had codependency issues, those of us who have had alcohol or drug addiction, almost all of us, like in the 80-plus percentile, had one or more parents with addictions or issues, and they never worked through them. Now, I'm old. I'm 61. I'm getting older. Yay! So I'm going to tell you that when my parents were having issues, they didn't have anyone who could talk to them. And mental health was something that no one talked about. Now, I'm not going to tell you that Life Recovery is all about mental health. It's not. It's just kind of one of the bonuses. It helps us. And it helps us when we can help others. Amen? All right, well, that's my plug for it. It's starting back this Friday night at 6 o'clock. Don't you love it? On January 6th at 6 p.m. Yes. Got a little hook there. Y'all got to remember that now. So at 6 p.m., we do meet right here. We don't care what you wear. I've got my hanging clothes on today. I'll be teaching art therapy in just a couple hours. We don't care what you wear. We don't care how you show up. We care that you show up and you have a desire to learn. We're going to be learning straight from the Life Recovery book, from the Life Recovery workbook. And it's going to be a little bit different this year. If you haven't never been to a meeting, show up. You might learn something. Heck, you might even like it. I want to come back. I want to see the church involved. We all need help. We all need unity. It's not like our other church groups. We watch some really cool contemporary Christian music videos. We sometimes do a couple of crazy idea. The Lord put that in my heart. We're going to be doing that. We're going to be working through the workbook. We do start with step one in January and go all the way through step 12 in December. We're just finishing up step 12 as of yesterday. And let me tell you what that was all about. In case you didn't know. It's just about carrying the message. That's all. Carrying the message. We can do that. That's what we're supposed to do. Let's carry his message. Okay, guys, I guess I'm not used to doing this. What else do I need to do? Oh, yeah. Men's life group, 6:30. Where's Danny at? Danny, stand up.
See, life events and injuries wounds to our vital organs, emotional wounds, are all not something that any of us want to have to experience. Life events never happen at a convenient time. Can I get an amen with that, right? So, to deal with these wounds, life as we have known it has to come to a complete stop. Right? Any of you ever had a loved one suffer a heart attack where they had to go in and crack open the chest and do all of the major surgery on the heart? The recovery time is not just like sew them up and let's go back out and, you know, play some catch, you know, right? It's a long process. I know my dad had to walk through something similar. He had quintuple bypass surgery like 12 years ago. Maybe even longer now. I think he didn't remember. It's been quite a while. And praise God, he's made it through very well. But it took a while for him to recover. And so when EMS arrives on the scene and someone is hemorrhaging from a wound, what do they do? Well, they put a tourniquet on it. Or they put a lot of gauze in the wound to temporarily deal with the wound of it. These actions are taken just to keep the person alive until they get to the hospital, right? That's the EMS's job. You know, all the emergency response team, they're there to just keep them alive until they get them to a place where they can give the proper care for the long-term care. Obviously, putting gauze in and a tourniquet on it is not a long-term solution. They're just actions to allow the person time until they get to the doctors and get the necessary long-term healing they need. Well, ministry done right is messy. I know. And none of us like to even think about that a lot of times. Now, I love the way Mama Jean was able to give a pitch about New Life Recovery, because I think sometimes we kind of think that New Life Recovery is just for all those that are hemorrhaging. But it's really for all of us that have probably taken up a wound and we don't know how deep and dark and ugly it is underneath. We need some surgery. And we need somebody to open it up and go, hey, let's deal with this right now. So I love that, because that's one of those ways for this house that we can help deal with some of the stuff that's underneath the surface. The wounds that we walk with, that God absolutely wants to heal. Ministry done right is messy. God doesn't require us to heal ourselves before coming to Him. He offers healing for those who respond to His drawing of the Spirit. So when we come to Him broken and bleeding and messy, this doesn't scare Him off, and nor should it scare us off as we minister to those in our community who are wounded and broken. Now, I've heard the church be referred to as a hospital, and I kind of like it, to be honest, because that's where broken, wounded people come for care and true healing. Because if we believe God is the great physician, then he should be able to not just practice care here, right? But he knows how to care for us even better than some of the practicing doctors we know. This is a place for broken and wounded people to come and actually be healed. I love this reference because I believe it depicts the heart of the Father to bring healing to all who enter into Him and His rest. I've also seen the flip side of this perspective, that Everyone must come cleaned up, with no problems, dressed in their Sunday best on the outside, and on the inside, there are wounds that are just not being dealt with. Everybody says hi to one another and asks the obligatory, how are you doing, followed by a less than highly favored response. You know, I'm all for speaking life and hope into our situations. Please don't hear what I'm not saying. But sometimes Jesus wants us to sit in our reality that He is the answer. Not just a change in our circumstance or a change in our situation. That's really a deep word today, I believe. Because sometimes we've associated following God that all of our answers are going to be answered, all of our questions are going to be answered, all of our stuff is just going to melt away, and it's going to be okay. Well, He offers grace and empowered favor with us to be able to walk through things. I mean, if there was another way than the cross, Jesus wanted that. Even in the garden, He said, Lord, if there is another way, let this cup pass from me. But there wasn't. Jesus had to walk through it. And this is, He knew what was coming. He knew it was going to hurt. He knew there was going to be pain involved. He was taking on the sin and becoming sin of humanity on the cross to pay for our sin debt. It was messy. The road to Golgotha was very messy. Sometimes Jesus wants us to sit in our reality that He is our answer. He's not just out to change our circumstance. He's out to change you. And out to change me. To do this, it requires us to be real with people in our lives that love us through these times. And it is a blessing to find groups of people that will do that, even just a handful. Right? Most of us have walked through, been around church long enough to know that it gets kind of messy around church. Yeah. And church people can be hurtful. Why? Because we're all flawed. We all bring our stuff to every relationship. Even our friendships. Even our church relationships. And sometimes it just gets messy. But Jesus is our focal point. Because the more we become more like Him, the more we reflect Him in our relationships. And all of us, I love our Wednesday night Bible study that we're doing around boundaries. We all need boundaries. And I love the way they started this talking about our different yards, right? I don't need to be helping someone in their yard if they're not willing to clean up their own stuff. You know what I mean? I can't be mowing their grass if they're not even willing to help, you know? Like, it's not my responsibility. The Holy Spirit may call me to do some of that, but the Holy Spirit has to call you to do that. It's not, we don't give more effort for somebody when they don't want to give effort themselves and make helping themselves. I don't know if that makes sense. Boundaries are necessary. And I'm learning some of that through this Bible study, that there are things in my life that I need boundaries for. And certainly in ministry is some of this. You know, it might be, when we talk about coming to church all dressed on the outside and looking pretty and, you know, things on the inside are different, you know, it might be easy to develop this church culture where It looks really nice on the outside, but inside we're all hurting and broken and everything's hidden, and the enemy keeps using that hiddenness to just keep hammering us, right? And we show up each week looking like we have it all together on the outside, but on the inside, we're just bleeding out. And what I mean by that is possibly like you're questioning everything, including your faith. But nobody would know because it's all just kind of pretty on the outside. Hey, how's it going? Well, I'm doing well. How you doing? Fine. How was your week? Great. I mean, none of us really want that. But it's so easy to go to that. So I want to challenge some of that today. We really need to and want to be loved and love one another, to be known and known by those around us. And we also want to be a church that is known for being authentic and real, that there are real people with real things that we're walking through, that we're having to walk through a season that Jesus may be asking us to sit in the reality of, I desperately need him every day during this season. I feel like the dominant church culture, which I've kind of called it churchianity around here. Churchianity, where it becomes this kind of facade of, we come, sing some songs, tell everybody we're great, you know, hear some nuggets and take it and go, man, that'd be great to apply that to my life. Monday, I'm back to doing whatever I do. Now, around here, I've seen different things. Amen. Yes, I'm seeing growth in our body. And I love that. But I want to keep us moving forward today, that we need to understand we don't have to come already cleaned up. So today my sermon title is Showroom or Emergency Room. If any of you been in a car dealership, you know what I'm talking about, right? The car showroom is where all of the latest, greatest, shiny new cars are put on display. They don't put that old 86 Pinto that's been changed out the engine four times. You know, they don't lay that up in there in that, you know, that showroom, right? They have the nice, clean, waxed, and strategically positioned so that when someone walks in looking for something else, the buyer may notice one of these other flashier, more expensive cars, right? Selling cars has a very strategic approach. In the way they take those approaches with every potential buyer. But isn't that the approach that modern churchianity has taken with church sometimes? I know that's a really icky question. But real. It's selling, but using a great marketing strategy to draw in people to an idea that doesn't even fulfill them in their deep inner being, because it was never meant to be all of that. The showroom churchianity, as we'll say today, puts all of the pretty people on stage, adds the fog machines, the big screens, and skinny jeans, you know, like I said before, to portray, you know, to portray this awesome thing for 23.2 minutes, asking the Holy Spirit, you got 23.2 minutes, Lord, to show up. And then we're on to something else. We have 23.2 minutes to express our love to Jesus. Right. Yeah, because nobody really knows who we are in a room full of people, we find ourselves still feeling alone and not known and we're just another person in the room, and we might even feel that way with Jesus, because that's what we portray. Showroom churchianity requires a very predictable expression from week to week that is a safe version of Jesus. Showroom churchianity does not require authenticity because it doesn't really have the spiritual depth or the biblical knowledge to actually apply powerful, non-talking kingdom of God to it. If the kingdom of God is not a talk but a power, and we see powerless churches dominate modern church culture, then where are we? What are we doing? Showroom churchianity is a ride many believers have hopped onto like we would in some amusement park roller coaster ride, right? For approximately 56 minutes and 32 seconds, we may or may not be asking the Holy Spirit to come do this incredible transforming work in our life. In some churches, that question of asking the Holy Spirit to come do something is not even relevant, because they have formulatically formed a strategy so good in their minds that they don't even need the Holy Spirit to show up, because they've done such a great job of putting together an emotionally moving, an emotionally manipulative service. I mean, I'm stepping off into it today. I'm about knee deep, right? I will not shake this off my foot right now. I'm just being real with you. I've experienced church all my life, and I've experienced a lot of that church. And I don't want a lot of that church. Praise God, we don't do a lot of that here. But some things we are guilty of. Some things we are guilty of. You know, after growing up in church, attending different kinds of churches, after traveling and singing, I personally cannot think of anything I'd rather not be a part of than churchianity. And personally, I know that I believe that's why so many people are leaving the church. One, because the word says it. Jesus said, "I'm warning, people are going to fall away." That's going to happen. But I think they are just experiencing dead religion. They try Jesus, try to apply all the truths and all the different things that they are in their head to it, but that nothing's really captured their heart, so they just kind of go back to what they know. Because why? The church itself is needing a Holy Spirit transformation, not just another nugget for us to take with us that week. Man, I long for a day where we just take up time hearing testimonies of what God's doing throughout, what He's done throughout the week. That's inspiring, right? And if we're spending time in the Word during the week, then we're not requiring whoever's up here to be our spoon-fed version of God that week. Because why? We're spending time in the Word. We're digging it out. We are learning ourselves from the Holy Spirit. Then we have questions. Maybe we can bring this into our Bible studies, into our life groups, and into our New Life Recovery. Man, we begin to build our faith together. And then Sundays are just this outflow. We can't wait. Can't wait to worship. We can't wait to share testimonies. And we get inspired, and it does it all over again. A church that is a true ER, that is willing to address all the obvious wounds, that's what I believe we desire here at New Day, and that Jesus desires from the body of Christ. Jesus himself was very acquainted with grief and sorrow. He knew about wounds physically. I think we would all understand that. If you've read any part of the scripture about his journey to Golgotha, you would know that. The passage of Christ movie depicted more than that. If it was any more than that, oh my goodness. Which it probably will. Jesus wept emotionally with people. He cared for people and started right where they are and right where they were. Psalm 147:3 gives us an idea of kind of what he's coming to do and how all this ties together. It says he heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. That sounds like what we want when people come to do that. That sounds like when wounded people, broken people show up, we want to see their wounds healed. Jeremiah 30:17 says, "For I will restore health to you, and your wounds I will heal, declares the Lord." Luke 10:34, this is Jesus talking. He says, he was sharing this in the context of a parable. So he went to him, bound up his wounds, pouring it on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. He went to him and bound up his wounds. Psalm 34:17-19. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. You see, if we were expected to come to him all cleaned up and whole before interacting with the body of Christ, then he would not have said, heal the brokenhearted and bind up their wounds. The reality is that all of us have brokenness. Why? Well, because this world is full of sin. It's full of sin. We partake of it, of that sin, and we feel its effects, which causes us to respond from that broken place that sin creates within us, which is why we need a Savior. If we've said yes to him, healing from this brokenness is not just possible, but guaranteed if we will allow the Holy Spirit free reign over our soul and our body. He promises it. We are all growing, hopefully, in maturity in our faith. And over the last 3.5 years, through the teaching in this house, I hope and I have seen that you are experiencing that growth in spiritual maturity, as well as applicable biblical knowledge, right? It's one thing to get a bunch of head knowledge, but if you don't know how to apply it, it's just head knowledge. But I feel like we've walked together through a lot of this, and we're seeing some fruit of that. We all desire to be, to love and be loved, to know and be known as human beings. This is how God made us. We have all found a measure of that in this house, and we desire for that to continue. Let's go to Galatians 6:1. So, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something, he is nothing. He deceives himself. But let each one test his own work. And then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor. For each will have to bear his own load. Let the one who is taught, or let the one who has taught the word share all good things with the one who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, especially those who are of the household of faith. The last verse I'll share here is 1 Thessalonians 5:14. It says, and we urge you, brothers, admonish the idle, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, and be patient with them all. It's okay to tell somebody, you know, today, it's been a rough day emotionally. I know the fact that even Mama Jean came here this morning, was here this morning, and even got up and did something that challenges her in sharing the announcements. She was up all night with her sister in Springfield, and we need to pray for her sister. It's okay to come in and go, hey, I'm really struggling today. I need some prayer. You're not speaking death over yourself. You're acknowledging what the reality is of where you are right now in this moment. Our feelings can feel a lot of different things, and they can take us to some unhealthy places, but in the moment, we can feel them, and it's okay to acknowledge them. And then we bring them to the Lord. Bring them to those that love us, and we get encouraged in the Lord because our faith and hope is in Him. When we are able to express that and receive prayer, that it really helps us realign back into the right fight against an enemy that is simply there to take us, you know, take from us everything that Jesus came for. So we're acknowledging what's taking place. I mean, Jesus in his state of being beaten while he's going up the Via Dolorosa quietly walked the journey. But he was encouraged by his mom and Mary. They were encouragement to him. There was only a few left, John as well, that stuck around, that actually walked with him and was an encouragement to him while he walked through that. He didn't just tell him, hey, it's going to be okay. I'll be done here in about 3 days. Y'all go back home. It's going to be all right. You know? No, he did, right? He knew how hurtful the whole experience, how physically hurtful it was for him. He knew how emotionally hurtful it was, even for his family. So it's through that authenticity that I want to share with you today kind of where we are, where my family is. So I have shared before, you know, just 3 or 4 weeks ago, just how our family is tired. My family is tired. And to say, I think we would qualify as the faint-hearted today. Now, we are seeing the Lord do even since some of the decisions that we are making have been kind of put in place and are moving forward we are seeing some healing. We're seeing some even strength in these times. But all I can tell you is 3.5 years ago, I became the lead pastor and elder at New Day Fellowship after we discovered some financial sin of a previous staff member. And as I mentioned a month ago from this podium, we have seen the Holy Spirit confirm, affirm, and move in acceleration and multiplication in several areas in this house as we have become more vocal about the mission and vision that God has placed over New Day and its leadership. And so while the Holy Spirit has given us some wonderful moments of affirmation, my family and I have had to work through relational trauma, our own individual spiritual journeys of forgiveness and letting go of past expectations. Doing this simultaneously, while whatever has been necessary to keep New Day moving forward, we have been doing the balancing of those plates. And at times it's been intermittently easy, and we felt the Holy Spirit just, you know, take and run with it. Then intermittently it's been very difficult, as others have had their own journeys of working through relational trauma and forgiveness, you know? We've not been exempt from any. The weight has been really heavy at times for Dale and I. And definitely more heavy than we realized on our family in totality. Didn't know what it was doing to our kids either. Our family has just filled ministry holes wherever and whatever has been needed. We've taken this approach for most of our ministry life. But this has proven to be a lot for all of us during this time of healing. We probably did not take enough time to heal from what happened 3.5 years ago. We just kept going. And as most of you have been through any kind of trauma or any kind of stuff related to deep hurts and wounds, man, when you stuff and go, it comes popping out later when you don't want it to, right? Uh-huh. It's coming out. You can either manage how it comes out, or it's going to come out for you later. And in self-destructive ways. So with the addition of 2 more elders and a very solid ministry leader team, this is a great opportunity for my family and I to take a much-needed time of rest from ministry obligations. I have shared before that 2022 was very difficult for my family and for many of us in the room. I want to acknowledge that most of us have been through quite a season in 2022. So I say that wanting to acknowledge that as well. But we've needed some rest. And it's probably long overdue. So this rest is coming through a sabbatical for most of my family, and it will be for the next 4 months. So at the 3-month mark, we will assess how we're feeling as a family, and if we need longer than that 4 months. But the sabbatical will be defined as this rest from any ministry obligations or being required of, with the option of adding additional time away if we're sensing it's what's needed. The sabbatical will mean myself and Danielle will not be serving in any capacity of leadership for at least the next 4 months. And so the first being next Sunday, which would be the 8th, next Sunday will be our first Sunday that we are not here. But we are, I want to say this very carefully, we are going to remain plugged in. We're going to be, I'm still We're still part of life groups on Tuesday night, Wednesday night recharge Bible study. I'm looking forward to boundary studies with Quinn, as well as new life recovery. That has touched Danielle and I both, and we have thoroughly enjoyed that. So as our schedule allows, we will be a part of that. So during this time, the elders and the ministry leaders, as well as our operations team, will be making decisions that align with the vision and mission that we've been casting for the past year. So there's nothing in my absence, in our absence, that's going to be different in that regard. Because we've been operating that way for a year. So the health of where we are as a body is awesome. And the leadership that is over this house is awesome. It's what really allows me to feel, us to feel the freedom to go, okay, yeah, let's rest. We need this rest. My family and I, do plan on taking some opportunities to do some life-giving things for our marriage, for our family, which may involve some traveling. So we will intermittently be attending on Sundays from the second month on. So this first month of Sundays, you won't see us here on Sundays, but we will be around during the week. Why? Because we're just attending. We're still a part of this family. And we're not running away from our family. We need our family. So I want that to be clear. So we are just removing ourselves from being relied upon to fill the holes. Being attenders versus being relied upon is the differentiating factor there of our involvement in New Day for the duration of this battle. We will still be a part of you, and we're here. And we're not going anywhere, all right? We're here, and we're healing, okay? But this first month, we're going to take, and afterward, we'll be intermittent, be in and out, because we're going to be doing some life-giving things that help pour into us. I want to spend time with Clay Nash, Clay and Susan. We're going to take a couple of trips to friends that we haven't seen in a long time that speak life into us. My family, we actually get to go see Caleb play drums at the church he's been serving at in Tulsa when he's in school. So he plays a full set over there. He's like, this is awesome. It's like, all right. We get to do some stuff together. But it'll be life-giving things for us. With us taking this sabbatical, this will mean more of you that call New Day your church home. You will be called upon to step up and serve as the body of Christ needs you in his house. Man, there's so much gifting in this room that we've not seen yet. And now is that time. I love the way you kind of talked about maybe we've been equipping, and you know, it's like teaching someone to ride a bike, you know, you have the training wheels off, and then you kick the training wheels off, and you go, now it's time to release you. Because it means something to me that this church is not about me. It's not about my family. There's so much of this journey that I didn't even want, to be honest. Because I knew I've been in ministry for 25 years as a music guy. I've seen what those pastors go through. And, I mean, ministry is messy. And it's really messy as a leader. So I need you guys to be praying for our elders and our ministry leaders and serve this house. Serve this house. We could serve together and shoulder the load together. So it will require for some of you to step up, many of you to. Some will be through something you're called to. Others may just be serving in necessary ways, but like, I mean, what I mean by that, none of us feel called to take out the trash, you know? I mean, or even mow the lawn or take out, you know, or make coffee, but it needs to be done, right? You know, it's just what we do is if we're a part of a house together, there's things that you got to do to take care of your house. And we do. We need more folks to help with this. And more needs will be revealed, and we will need others just to step into those places. But and they will let you know what those areas are as we move forward. And just being very authentic with you is we need you, church body. We need you. If you have enjoyed the ministry of this house, it is time to step into it and serve it. If you're not already doing that. And I'm just going to lay it out there again. Just being raw and honest with you. The worst thing that could happen for us as a family trying to rest will be for people not to show up and go church shopping during this time. Yeah. I'm just laying it out there. I'm telling you right now. We need you. Mm-hmm. That's not restful. Right. Like, man, Paul didn't leave early. Yeah, no, we're not going anywhere. We're still here. We're rested. So we can come back and give all that we can to areas that God has called us to versus all the different things we're trying to plug. All right? You get this, right? Tell me, yeah, placement. I'm not doing a boogie up here or anything. Yeah. So we need you here. Okay? Do you understand that? You don't need it. I'm not. Yes, we just need you here. Okay? We will all walk this journey together. And my prayer is that we get the opportunity to come back rejuvenated and re-energized and see God finish 2023 with amazing multiplication and acceleration. And I'm hoping and praying that that actually happens while we're gone. Wouldn't that be so good? Yeah. Be all over that. We're like, cool, all right, this is awesome. I love you, church family. I know Danielle does too. I want to stand. Hey, you, will you come up here with me? Yeah. I got family up here with me. Babe, Dax, Kay. Oh, Babe's in the nursery. All right. Fill in the hole. All right, somebody else can fill a hole for it. Yes. But see, I mean, that's just an example. I mean, just stand right there. See, my kids are willing. Why? I mean, it's time for us to step up as a body. We need more folks serving in the children's. So that Leah and Ron and Chris can we can't be here and be in service to be fed. Let's all shoulder the load together. Okay? So again, my prayer is that as you see us, my kids will be here intermittently. All right, so they will, I mean, they might, they, yeah, Caleb's only got a couple more Sundays before he has to go back, so he's probably still going to play. So he was like, Dad, he goes, oh, yeah, I'm like, that's cool, it's all good. So we won't be far, and we are here, and we are walking with you. But this first month, we won't be, because there needs to be an opportunity for you guys to work with the elders and the ministry leadership to fill some holes. And it will make us stronger as a body to do so. And I hope you know this after being around here, but I'm going to shoot you straight. I'm going to be honest with you. And I'm going to share with you my heart. Anything else you hear other than what you've heard today isn't right. Okay? I'm just telling you, all right? My family just needs some rest. Okay? That's all it is. And we are getting that opportunity because this is an awesome body of believers. And I appreciate it very much. So thank you today. Thank you. I would like to ask Quinn and Michelle and our ministry leaders if they would come and pray over our family today, and then we'll be dismissed.
How are you guys doing? We're good, right? Because we serve a big God. And he's not caught by surprise, even though some of you may be today. Paul has been sharing these things with us for some time now, and we are grateful to be a part of this family and be able to stand with you. There were three scriptures that the Lord gave me for you guys today. That I felt were just words of life for your family. The first is Romans 15:13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. He's your hope. Don't lose sight of that. Let that hope fill your heart. Because Hebrews 6:19 says, this hope, which is Christ, we have as an anchor of the soul, a hope both sure and steadfast, and one which enters within the veil, where Jesus has entered as a forerunner for us, having become a high priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. And then Habakkuk 3:19, Adonai, my Lord, is my strength. He has made my feet like a deer's, and he will make me walk on high places. That is what I see in the spirit when I pray for you, family, that this sabbatical time of rest is a time where hope will fill your hearts as you focus on the Lord, and that his spirit will empower you with feet like hinds' feet to soar upon the high places, that you guys are going to break through in the areas where you have felt held back. You are going to cast off the bonds that have held you. And you're going to come out from that fire without the bonds and not even smelling like smoke. Father, we thank you for Paul and Danielle, Caleb, Dex, and Bailey. We thank you for this family. And I hear you say, I bless you, Harris family. Your Heavenly Father blesses you in this step of faith that you're taking. And it is a step of faith. We bless you as your church family. We bless you in this journey. And we are so excited to see what God does in each one of you.
May we speak that same hope over this congregation this morning as I was praying for you all. And I would just say, ministering spirits, dripping hopefulness on each of us. And dripping hopefulness into our mouths and rubbing it in. And just the words of our mouth and the meditation of our hearts would be acceptable and pleasing. And any hope deferred that makes the heart weak, we just convince that in the name of Jesus, and we speak hope and peace and life and wisdom beyond our own work, God. And I've just been seeing us locking arms and marching on, you know, just surrounding them in prayer, but also rising up and stepping up in areas that will need to be filled, and just locking arms and holding hands and marching forward. And we just thank you for this time of rest. We speak peace over the Harris family and divine healing in Jesus' name in every area of their lives. And we thank you for it, God. Thank you, Jesus.
Paul, I just want to thank you for the show of courage today, for all of us being a man and you being the leader of this house and the leader of your family, that to acknowledge that you need the rest and to have that courage to acknowledge it. That is a tremendous show of strength. And that's a great encouragement to me personally, but I know to this body. So we love you guys.
Is there someone that has a prophetic word from the Lord? I'm sensing that there's some prophetic encouragement that the Lord wants to give through some of you. So if you're hearing right now from the Spirit, come on up. Don't be shy. Just surrender to the Holy Spirit. We asked Him for His leadership in this service, and so thank you, Julie.
Well, I just want to encourage you. What I'm seeing is that you are a forerunner family. You're a forerunner family. You're stepping out where so many thousands upon thousands of ministers wish that they could have done that, and that they would have done that when it was too late. So I encourage you. And you stand in that forerunning spirit and stand strong and know that God is going to take you through, bring you through. And I'm looking forward to it. We're going to be here. And I encourage the body. When there's sickness, we give meals. And we're there to support. And this is what we all need. This is what our family members need. And I pray that we will show ourselves strong in the Lord, and in the power of His might to do the right godly thing that makes a huge difference for not only this body, but even visitors who might come in. And I just believe this is like a flood, like a fire that's going to begin to burn through the body of Christ, and it's so needed. And so I just say, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord for what you're doing. Praise the Lord for what you're doing. Going to be together as a family and a body. Amen.
It will be vital for us to come alongside in prayer. If I word from the Lord around, I'm going to hold this and you can hold me. How's that?
Or get closer to my people. Daniel, you saved my life. And I'm going to do everything I can to restore you. Your kids, I think, are okay. So I just pray for you, Danielle,
again, Father, for the privilege it is to allow us to stand with the people that you have placed in leadership over us. Thank you both for their hearts to serve you, their hearts just for you, Lord, and for your people, and for everyone that could be your people, but maybe out there. God, we just wait expectantly on what you're going to do. I'm excited about it. I can't imagine how cool things are going to get. But Lord, I just ask that you walk with them every step of the way. And I know you already do. And I thank you for that. I thank you, Lord, for what you've already done in their lives. Wow. You're a big God. I'm glad you are God. Thank you, Lord. We love you so much. Thank you, Lord, for who you are in the midst of who we are. Jesus, we love you, Lord. And we thank you so much for this family here. We thank you for the way that they have led us. We thank you, Jesus, for their hearts. We thank you for the courage, God, that it's taken for them to accept this rest. Jesus, I pray that you will, that your Holy Spirit will guide us on how we can best support this family, God. Pray, Lord, that they are reminded during this time just how much you love them, Jesus, and that you see them, and that you cherish each one of them, God. I pray that you show us new ways to love on them, to be that support that they need, God. And I just pray restoration over this family and every area, Lord. And I just pray that your Holy Spirit will just envelop this family, God, that they would feel your Spirit around them stronger than ever, Jesus. And we just lift them up to you, God, because we trust you. And we know, God, that you are doing wonderful things in their lives, even right now, God, to heal you as we can. Jesus, and we just thank you for that. And we just pray that they know just how much you love them and how much we love them, and that we are behind them in this, Jesus. We praise your name, Jesus. Amen.
I know people this just tears. You know, who else is greeting? Give me more than just an introduction. And it's hard to see your family struggle. And you're my family, you're my best friends. And I know you've walked with me through my struggle. I promise we'll be here for you. We love you. It is our job as a church, as a family, to support you. And it's been hard seeing you struggle. Not just because of the struggle, but because of who you are to me. Because of what you mean to me. But I know God is in this. In this decision. I'd like to see these kids grow up. And I love them like a mom. And I watch them grow up in God more than anyone. And it has been a blessing as your youth minister, as your friend, to watch you grow in God. And it doesn't end just because of this. This is a new day. God, I come here out and I follow the Lord and I lift my family to you. Not just these stuff right here, but even the ones that listen. God, it is evident and obvious that you live through me. That your love flows out of the
that you fill them with your love. Not only just for themselves, but for those around them. Father, they give so much to everyone else. It is time for them to give to themselves, to rest, to feel, to be emotionally and spiritually strengthened. So they can continue to give to you. And we give you honor in knowing that they've been an amazing example of who you are in everyday life. That we've been able to lean on them for so many years. Now it's time for them to be able to rest and be a lead on others. So let that happen. Let them take this time to grow, to be filled, and just to rest so their wounds can be healed, so they can be free of the burden of the past. God, it's not a coincidence that you tell us in Scripture that our sins are thrown into the sea of forgiveness. You want us to let go. But Father, as humans, it's so much easier said than done. Right now is to be free from the past so the future can be focused on solely on you. Nothing more, nothing less, just you. That the journey can be one of grace and one of peace because you are the journey. So I give you honor and knowledge. Through this time of rest, that the healing is going to come. The peace through you will come. And we pour that into you right now. Thank you for this amazing family that you've given us to lean on and to learn and to love. And let us continue to do that every day. Let us make sure as a church life they don't forget that they're loved and that they're supported and appreciated for all they've done. Thank you, Father, for this family. For these years since you.
Thank you guys so much. Appreciate the prayers and the opportunity to do this. Not every minister does get this opportunity. And maybe they don't take it, maybe they don't get it off, have it offered, but I appreciate the opportunity for us to rest. And yeah, we're expecting God to do great things through it. There's been so much affirmation, even since the Lord revealed to Daniel and I that we needed a sabbatical. And it's just been one affirmation after the other. And so today is another one of those for us. And so we just say thank you. And appreciate you very much. And we will walk the journey together. Yeah. All right, I'll pray us out. Let's let everybody be dismissed about that. Oh, dear Lord, thank you. Lord, you're so good. You are worthy of all the praise and all the glory. Lord, use this time of rest for us as a time to strengthen New Day and strengthen this body, to have people step up together and be Jesus to this community, but even just to start with, just to be for each other. Be Jesus to each other and serve willingly and faithfully as we walk the journey together. Lord, we do love you.